Hello, everyone. Welcome to this edition of CBN News Sunday. I'm George Thomas. America may be on the path of destruction that would make her no longer the greatest nation in the world. That's what some researchers believe. CBN's Paul Strand explains why.
This time of year, Americans are used to celebrating the nation's birthday and its greatness, but they may soon be mourning its downfall. That's a conclusion of researcher George Barna and historian David Barton in their book, U-Turn, Restoring America to the Strength of Its Roots.
These authors say that the U.S. is entering its own version of the Dark Ages, that any civilization that's gone where America is headed now has gone to ruin.
The founders gave us an amazing foundation, and for us to trample on it and say we're going to build a new one is folly.
The authors point out those early Americans were shaped by the Bible and a Judeo-Christian worldview.
They believed everybody should read through the Bible cover to cover once a year. That's what we did in school. That's what we did in spiritual life. That's what political leaders did. Not today. We can't even get Christians to read that word.
Today, only 30% of Christians read the Bible and less than 10% from cover to cover. And it shows.
Only 9% of born-again Christians have a biblical worldview. Only 51% of pastors have a biblical worldview.
It's led to a complete change in values over 240 years. Then, service to others ruled the day.
Your order of responsibilities is God, country, and family. And so that's part of the biblical thinking they had, which is why the founding fathers were told and specifically taught in schools. We have their textbooks. If someone comes to you and say, we need you to run for office, you're not allowed to say no. You said, I will run. Because, as they point out, your life doesn't belong to you.
Today, it's all about me.
Now we're just worried about comfort and experiences and entertainment and security.
That's led to a world of things that can pile up the kind of debt that can kill a country.
Barna and Barton found in their research over and over again that church people are just as guilty as their government, as secular people, of the same kind of ruinous behaviors that are taking the nation down.
In a country that between 78-80% say they're Christian, but only 34% believe in absolute moral truth.
Barna on a regular basis asks Christians and non-Christians about 70 moral categories. And these days he's finding no substantive statistical difference between Christians and non-Christians when it comes to most moral issues.
Stop pointing the finger and look at ourselves and say, are we really the church that Christ died on the cross for?
Barna says today's Americans believe they're smarter than the founders, maybe because of education and technology. But the founders had that biblical foundation.
They didn't have all the things that we think are necessary to have a sophisticated society today. But the key isn't sophistication. You know, it's wisdom, it's discernment, it's love, it's grace.
And so until we get back into God's plan and know what His plan is, we'll never get the nation back to where it needs to be.
Today we think that mankind has evolved. We're smarter and wiser than those people who founded the country hundreds of years ago. And yet they were so wise that they founded the greatest nation on the earth, while today's generation are well on their way to losing it. Paul Strand, CBN News, reporting from Lancaster Bible College.
Thanks, Paul. CBN's Gary Lane is here. He recently interviewed Sam Rohr with the American Pastors Network about what Christians can do about America's moral dilemma. What did he say?
That's right, George. Rohr's group has seen the research, and they're trying to do something about it. Now, he believes his organization has a divine calling at this critical time in American history.
From the idea of being identifying, equipping, and educating pastors in the pulpit to stand in the gap for truth. And then we do other things relative to radio programs and demonstrating what it should be like and what it looks like for pastors in the pulpit to actually be addressing the issues of the day and what it means by applying a biblical worldview to the issues of the day, which is so desperately needed in these days. So we really are focused on pastors, not as a means to an end, but as the position divinely called of God, which we believe, if you could put it in terms of the tip of a spear, we believe that pastors are the tip of the spear in the proclamation of truth, because as Paul told Timothy, they are to preach the word. So we believe that pastors in the pulpit called of God are to preach the word into the individual's life, into the family's life, into the church's life, obviously, but also into civil government, all the areas of jurisdiction that God has established. And we believe that the pulpits of America have been silent for nearly a generation and have been quiet on the issues. and have not applied biblical principles, and we sit here today in a nation, I believe, a nation that perishes for lack of biblical knowledge. So we are there to focus on what we believe God focuses on, and if we believe and hope and pray that God will send a revival to America, it's going to have to start with the people of God and the house of God, and if the pastors in the pulpit do not stand up and lead the house of God, there will be no revival, but we believe that they can, and we believe that God would have it start right there.
Wow, some incredible words. Gary, what did he say about the leaders of America's churches?
Well, he's saying not enough of them, George, are being obedient to God's Word. He said it starts with obedience to morality, to God's Word, to biblical truths, and then following through with that and preaching that, and on a regular basis, not just every now and then, but doing it regularly.
And where is this, like, why is that not happening in the pulpits, especially in our day and age?
Well, I think we're getting into a feel-good type of church situation now, where we want people to feel good about Christianity. We don't necessarily want to say Jesus. We don't necessarily want to talk about hell, homosexuality, and issues like that, sexual sin. But we want to feel good. Mm-hmm. We want to come away from church feeling good about ourselves. How can we apply this to our day-to-day lives without really getting deep into the Word and biblical truths?
What did he say about biblical literacy specifically and that worldview? Yeah. What did he say?
Well, he's saying that there aren't enough pastors who really understand the Bible or even accept that it is the divine Word of God. I think that many of them feel it's open to interpretation, and that's why we're seeing the Episcopal Church in America accept gay marriage and other things, abortion. For example,
it doesn't make it easier when people are not reading their Bible as well. I mean, George Barna talks about this. The American church community is not reading their Bible. They don't know the tenets of the faith.
And you've seen that around the world. Many other countries, people are just long just to have one Bible to read, and if they get it, they'll read it regularly.
They'll consume the whole thing.
But many Americans may have 3, 4, or 5 Bibles on the shelf and never read it.
Okay, Gary, stay with us. Don't go anywhere. Coming up, biblical literacy leads to a moral decline in America. Well, what can Christians do about this? And welcome back to CBN News. We are talking about the moral decline of America, but God. CBN's Gary Lane is here with more. Gary, is there hope for America?
Of course there's hope. And if you talk to Rohrer and these pastors that he represents, they'll all tell you the hope is in Jesus Christ. Obedience to the Bible, God's Word, and then coming forth and living it, George.
And in some ways, you know, he talks about, you know, he can, you know, the idea of using the remnant, using the grassroots movement to fuel fire and bring revival within the church.
Yes, and Rohrer believes God can use a remnant and his group's grassroots efforts to restore the church's influence once again in America.
But the greater majority of them have not even been preaching on marriage. You know, less than 20% of the pastors polled across America in 2014 were even planning on preaching one sermon in 2015 on marriage. Not against same-sex marriage, but for marriage. And I, back to your question, I believe that the silence of the pulpits of America in preaching on the faithfulness in marriage and the picture of marriage and what it means with Christ in the church and why it's so sacred, the failure to do that have allowed Christian marriages in our churches to be filled full of many people in the pews who have not been faithful in their own heterosexual marriages, and it has led the way and paved the path for what the Supreme Court has done. This court did not start a new chapter by their ruling. I believe, in fact, they've almost put an exclamation point on the end of a sentence that's being written for a generation.
Yeah, more than 30 states already had adopted same-sex marriage, had they not?
Well, the court overruled laws in some of those states, and not that the states have actually adopted that, but certainly that's what the proponents have said. But again, the understanding of law, moral law, God's expectation, as well as the constitutional law and what can be done and so forth, these are all wrapped together, and we think ought to be something that's actually preached from the pulpit.
So, Sam, what is the appropriate response for Christians? Should we go out in the street, have rallies and protests? What should be done?
I think it's a great question. We are very, very, very concerned that our response as Christians, pastors in the pulpit, Christian organizations, do not respond fleshly or humanly and in a reactive mode. many are speaking about we've got to be prepared, we've got to organize ourselves with civil disobedience. I've seen many use the word defiance and so forth. I'm very, very concerned about that, Gary, because God hates rebellion. God blesses obedience. We believe that the pastors in the pulpit and Christians themselves should be more concerned about biblical obedience and saying, what am I doing in my own life? If I'm a pastor, am I preaching the whole counsel of God? Am I actually taking the principles of God's Word and teaching my people how to live biblical obedience? Now, it may lead us absolutely, say, to obey God rather than man. It may mean that we will disobey an ungodly law. We say we must think just like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. We must be prepared to step into the fire. But it's being driven by the fact of our obedience to God more than we are reacting against and saying no to the idolatry of the moment. So biblical obedience, Christians look within, pastors preach biblical obedience.
And there is a cost to that obedience. Look at what happened in Oregon. You have two bakers there, $135,000 fine, a gag order against them simply because they would not bake a same-sex marriage wedding cake.
And Gary, you see, we as Americans have been the beneficiary of a freedom that has been really unparalleled in the history of this world. And it's come because we've had pastors and those in office before who have held a biblical worldview who've basically God has blessed us because of what they've done. We are not ready for persecution.
But it's coming, is it not?
Well, it's already here and it is increasing. That is why we must, as believers, be saying, we will serve God, we will obey God rather than man, but we must understand what the Bible says and we must be committed to complete biblical obedience first, and then God will lead us in the right response if we are right there.
So do you see more Oregons, more situations like that coming down the pike?
I think there's no question about it. Matter of fact, the other side, the ACLUs of the world, the Americans Separate from United Church of State, I mean, these kinds of groups that have caused problems, they are energized. They have been energized by this recent court ruling. They are actively looking for examples for which they can make an example. So all of those who are committed to truth should in every way be thinking about their actions, not deterred from doing the right thing, but I'd say energized as well to stand for truth like never before, but be prepared that we may encounter the law in a way that we are not used to in this nation.
Is it the end of religious liberty here in America?
I believe that we're already seeing the undermining of religious liberty. I don't think the end is here. We're not yet Red China, Communist China. We are not yet some of these. But Gary, the underpinnings of the rule of law, the undercutting of the moral law, biblical law, has been cut out of our system long ago. We threw God out of the schools. We took the Bible out of the schools. We said we cannot have the Ten Commandments on the wall. We made death in the womb, abortion, legitimate. Now it's a marriage court. We've been on this course for a long time. God is not pleased. We cannot shake our fist in the face of God and say, at the same time, ask for His blessing. So it's happening, Gary.
Well, the Supreme Court also made a decision on Obamacare. Now, what is the appropriate Christian response to that? Obviously, most Americans and Christians would like to see, be compassionate and see those that don't have insurance get insurance and so forth. How should we respond?
Well, Gary, I mean, the Bible does not say thou shalt have health care. You know, so we're not dealing with an issue that's quite straight up as much as taking of life or marriage. We are talking about something, though, that does get into what is the appropriate role of government in this matter. And the government has gotten involved in an area that is not in their jurisdiction. The caring for the poor and all of that is not a government responsibility. It should be coming out of the church. It should be coming out of another entity. They've involved themselves wrongly. They are
undercutting. Well, have they involved themselves because the church hasn't been stepping up and doing its job?
I think for a generation, the church has stepped back because government has stepped in, and the church says, well, frankly, if they're wanting to do it, then let them do it. They do at a great cost. And so now the church is on the outside. We're on the outside saying, wait a minute. How can you be doing this? In essence, in many cases, if we look in the mirror, we say, we gave it up. So for a Christian's mentality, we got to be thinking, all right, what is the church's responsibility? What is the role of government? And we must be pursuing that, should God give us the mercy and ability to do that, to reclaim what the church ought to be doing in meeting the needs of the poor and the widows and the orphans, all of those things which are the church's responsibility, that must say that is our responsibility, and we will, in fact, take that because the government will fail, as we know they are. They can't run it. God never intended it. And whatever they touch in this area fails. And so we have to be thinking, what's the biblical model? Let's preach it. Let's teach it. And it will come around that we'll find out, again, is the best way.
Wow, you guys covered a lot of topics in that one segment. Yes. I mean, but he says, you know, the church is on the outside and the church has given up. I mean, do you get that sense? And he clearly is stating that, that the church has, in essence, washed its hands of the cultural issues that we're facing today.
I wouldn't say all churches, but I would say the majority of churches. And the reason, what the point that sticks with me, George, is with Rohrer saying, look, we haven't done our job socially and in government, politically. Civil obedience as well. I think the key here is, why are these things happening to the culture? It's happening because many Christians have stepped away. Government steps in when there's a void. There's a void that has happened because Christians haven't been doing what we are supposed to be doing, feeding the poor and caring for those less fortunate. On the government side, we've stepped away and said, no, we can't be involved. This politics is dirty. We can't be involved in that because we're above that. Yeah. Well, look what happens. Then you end up with Supreme Court rulings like you have. Mm-hmm. You have government running away and trying to dominate the society and the culture and the government with ungodly things and with approaches that aren't necessarily biblical.
And it's interesting, he made the point, you know, we cannot, Christians cannot respond in anger when you see these issues like a gay marriage and so forth, that we cannot operate out of our flesh, our carnal, but instead we have to communicate the love of Christ.
And part of being obedient to God is demonstrating the love of Christ, showing love. Remember, Jesus said, love one another.
Yeah. Okay. All right, folks. Well, up next, there are issues that aren't so easy for Christians to take on, like immigration. Up next, how should we approach these topics and much more? Stay with us. We'll be back right after this. And welcome back to CBN News Sunday. We're discussing the moral state of our country. Joining me is senior international reporter Gary Lane. Gary, let's talk about the Confederate flag. I mean, huge, very, very controversial in the last several weeks. Why do you think this flag is causing so much controversy and has stirred up these emotions across the country?
Well, of course, some people, especially in the South, look at that flag and they remember those that sacrificed for the Confederacy. Many of them have ancestors that died fighting for the Confederacy. But other Americans, especially African Americans, see it as a symbol of hate and racism. And I think, George, that is, that's the real issue.
And what does Rohrer say to you? What did he say about this issue? And really looking at the, you know, the motivation behind the flag.
Yeah. Well, Rohrer says there's more than just the intolerance and the way that people look at this. He encourages us to address the motivation that is behind lowering the flag. Take a look.
I think, Gary, in that respect, we back up and say, all right, what in fact is the motivation for the taking down this flag? Is it really a racial issue? Or is it an American heritage issue? I have heard many black leaders stand and say this aspect of the flag has nothing to do with slavery, because they're already talking about, then we got to tear down the statues of General Lee and Stonewall Jackson.
It doesn't stop with the battle flag.
It does not stop with the flag. And there are things, you know, with those who have tried to undercut our heritage, they would also like to get rid of our flag generally, period. They want to cut us loose from everything relative to our founding fathers. We have to be very careful that in this rush to be politically correct, we don't do harm to the history of our nation that, in fact, wasn't all about the slavery issue. And many of the folks down south here, they fully understand it, as well as the folks up north. We understand that too. So we say, exercise caution on this. Let's not go throwing the baby out with the bathwater. What is the issue? And be cautious.
And one aspect that has been equally divisive, a related topic, is the issue of illegal as well as legal immigration here in the United States.
That's right, George. This is something that is facing America. It's bound to be a deciding topic, a hot topic, for the upcoming presidential election. And Rohrer has a unique take on the topic.
So if someone is here illegally, government has responsibility to deport them if they're here illegally. But God tells us a lot in the Old Testament, and he punished Israel for their improper behavior towards the immigrants, for those who came to their nation because they saw the blessing of God on Israel, and they wanted to participate, and they came for the worship of God. God said, you did not deal with them appropriately, and God judged them. 2 Chronicles chapter 6, one of Solomon's prayers, talks about that. So we have to be very careful. We're here as immigrants, but we're here as citizens under law. We must be careful in our attitude, be loving and merciful. If someone is here because they want the blessings of America and they want to worship our God, we've got to point them to God. If we pull them away, and I believe what government's doing now is instead of pointing our immigrants to God of heaven, the source of our blessings, they're embroiling them and pointing them to the God of government and making them dependent. That's what God is going to judge. That's what God, I believe, is judging. Our attitude, though, must be if they come because they want to be a recipient of our blessing and worship our God, we should welcome them.
Before we close out this broadcast this weekend, you know, something we like to do here at CBN is to pray. We believe in the power of prayer. We are facing some very, very difficult social issues across this country. So, Gary, would you lead us, and then I'll close.
Yes. Okay. Lord Jesus, we thank you for these many years of blessing this country from the time of its inception. And we pray right now in your name that we return to obedience to you, but we represent ourselves as ambassadors of you in a loving and a kind way to those who may oppose us. So be with us, Lord, and may there be revival in our land.
Yes, Lord. And in that same vein, Lord, I just pray for the pastors, those who stand upon the pulpits across our nation. Would you give them the spiritual spine to stand straight in the midst of the tsunami of sin that we see encroaching upon our nation across this country, Father? Would you give them the fortitude, the spiritual fortitude to continue speaking light and hope into these dark places? We thank you in Jesus' mighty name.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you so much, Gary. Well, folks, that's it that we have all the time we have for CBN News Sunday. You can catch all the news that matters to you 24/7 at cbnnews.com. Or you can follow us on Facebook and Twitter. Hey, social media, come tell us what you think about this show and continue to give us your encouragement or even story ideas. Until next time, on behalf of Gary Lane, everyone here in the studio and in the control room, thank you so much and God bless.